Part 2. The Storm. 6 months before Sara's fateful picnic with Jane in Central Park, on a beautiful Monday morning, Captain Jack Hewitt left harbor in his commercial fishing boat for a 3-day trip from New York City. The Mozart, named for the captain's favorite composer, held 3 crewmen and their captain. The boat was light and small, designed to travel a great distance quickly, and offered agility that reminded Captain Hewitt of music. He had the Mozart custom-built to be light and fast, reaching an amazing cruising speed of 55 knots, with the ability to hit 100 knots flat out. The boat measured 35 feet, with an 8-foot beam and a 5-foot draft. The Mozart was made of fiberglass, chosen for its lightweight and maximum flexibility against harsh ocean waves. It was fully equipped for open water with the latest navigational equipment and autopilot, so that, when necessary, Captain Hewitt could assist his modest crew with their tasks and let the ship navigate itself. Captain Hewitt was a 5th-generation fisherman who'd lived on the water most of his life. A lean man with a powerful upper body, he was well-trained by experience and could do all the tasks required of each of his crew members. Over the years, he assembled a crew with whom he worked well. Brian, the boat's first mate, had worked for him for more than 5 years. Very resourceful, the big man could handle himself well in tough situations and could do the work of 3 normal crew members. Henry, the boat's mechanic, had worked with Captain Hewitt for 20 years. He'd mastered both the mechanics of the boat and Captain Hewitt's idiosyncrasies. John, an ecology student at NYU, filled out the crew, as he had the previous summer. Anticipating his graduation the following year, he wanted to spend time at sea, observing and studying the ocean. At 22 years old, he had a baby face not yet lashed by years of wind and sea. Small and thin, he looked the part of an intellectual. Besides giving him insight into his studies, being on the open ocean lifted his spirit. At sea, he felt free, away from all the world's troubles. Captain Hewitt's family loved the ocean and made the ocean their lives. That had led to problems for him. His wife divorced him 10 years ago after only 7 years of marriage, when she grew tired of his seafaring life. The couple did not have children, and the divorce wasn't too hard on the salty captain. He had his work and his love of the ocean, and made his work his life. Although he had equipped the Mozart with modern electronics, he trusted his instincts as often as he did the machines designed to find fish. He knew exactly where to go and what time of the day in each season to catch the most of whatever fish were selling best at the time. That was why he designed the Mozart for short, fast trips, so that he could take the best advantage of changing market opportunities and the desires of his regular restaurant clients for the freshest fish of different types. The sky darkened suddenly just after dawn one morning as the Mozart neared its destination on the rolling Atlantic. Moments later, a thunderous storm appeared, seemingly out of nowhere, catching the veteran seaman off guard. Captain Hewitt usually could read the weather several days in advance, but even he was surprised. He gazed with awe at the storm as it approached, quiet, with shocked disbelief. He'd never before seen such a large, sudden change. The crew scurried to secure the nets and miscellaneous gear which was laid out in preparation for the day's fishing, but there wasn't enough time. The destructive wind and waves attacked the boat quickly and violently, and the crew could do little but watch the rain and wind pound the boat. Giant waves tossed the boat, and waves rushed over the deck. Captain Hewitt ordered the others below deck as he called a Mayday alert on the radio.
"Mayday, Mayday, Mayday! This is fishing vessel Mozart!"
He repeated the boat's name, following the radio protocol that he spoke as a second language. "Echo, Alpha, 6, 4, 8, 200 miles east of Nantucket Island. We're outclassed by weather." If there had been time for emotion, he might have been embarrassed to broadcast to the world that his craft was unprepared for mere weather, something he studied and usually could avoid or prepare for. There was no time for such an emotion, only for emergency protocol. The weather deteriorated, and the unimaginable happened. First, his custom diesel engine shut off by itself. Then, the electronics failed despite the battery backups. In an instant, all of the boat's electronic instruments were useless. The crew could do little but get below deck and lock the hatch tightly. The hatch sealed out the wind and water, but the living compartment was designed for only 2 men to sleep at a time and was barely big enough for 4 to sit down together. The violent sea twisted and twirled the boat for nearly 2 days, but the sturdy boat's hull didn't yield to the pressure, and the Mozart rode out the huge waves without capsizing. Safe and warm within the sleeping quarters, swaddled in thick bedding to protect against the bumps and bounces, the crewmen were terrified, but safe. The quarters were warm from their bodies pressed in so closely, and dark in the absence of electric light, or even sunlight because of the storm. The sound of waves crashing against the decks and the buffeting and rolling of the waves became hypnotic, almost comforting. Fortunately, none of the crewmen were prone to seasickness because the ship rolled and pitched furiously. Everyone's adrenaline was spent after the first few hours of the storm, so they settled into a bewildered boredom over the ensuing days. The drinking water ran out at the beginning of the second day of the storm. The desalinization pump had gone offline when the electricity went out, and they hadn't stored much fresh water. Luckily, the other provisions from the galley were sufficient. The rocking of the ship and the darkness prevented them from playing cards or other games, and eventually their throats burned from lack of water, so no one talked much. Even so, they were strangely comfortable in the midst of great peril, and they drifted in and out of sleep as the gale wore itself out. Then the madness quelled, the wind and waves died out, and the boat ceased its rocking. After more than 2 days of the storm, the crew made their way out onto the deck, led by Captain Hewitt. What they saw put them in awe, and their expressions looked as if they were seeing heaven itself. Everything surrounding them was dazzling white, calm and still. They were surrounded by oceans of floating ice. Some chunks were basketball-sized, others as big as a house. Some were so big that a city could be built upon them. None of them had ever seen such a magnificent sight. "Look," John said, pointing to a massive block of ice so big that their eyes could not see its sides or far edge. As the other crewmen turned to look at the massive iceberg, the calm and quiet were shattered by crackling noise followed by a wet thump. Sounds like cannon shots boomed across the water amid more thumps.
"What's that sound?" asked Henry.
"The ice melts," said John, "and weakens. Those booms are the sounds of slabs cracking off."
"Ice makes such a sound?" said Henry, incredulous.
"The thumps," John added, "are when the slabs fall into the ocean."
"Wow,"
said Brian, understating the spectacle before them.
"Those icebergs are gigantic," John told the others, drawing on knowledge of the ocean from his studies that the others had not learned from their years of experience.
"The floating ice all came from that mass. The pieces break off as it melts, and now they're drifting." Softer splashing sounds crackled in the background like static. After a big slab fell, football-sized chunks that cleaved at the same time rained like shrapnel. The crew didn't realize it, but they were witnessing a symptom of one of humankind's greatest tragedies. The massive land of ice was falling apart piece by piece, the victim of a warming climate. The massive icebergs cleaved and calved naturally, as well as growing and shrinking seasonally. But in the past few hundred years, the natural rhythm and balance of those processes had been disturbed. The side effects of humankind's industrial progress had changed the composition of Earth's atmosphere, resulting in artificial warming. The change, though just a few degrees, meant the slow reduction in size and eventual destruction of icebergs that had accumulated and held steady for millions of years. What the crew witnessed was more than a mass of ice breaking apart and melting away. They were looking at the destruction of a force that, in ways they might not live to understand, had kept humankind from becoming extinct. In awe of the stunning sight, the crew watched the icebergs float, noting that many of the large pieces were coming closer and closer together. They realized they had to act quickly to prepare the boat and escape before it became trapped and crushed.
"I think we have about 10 minutes before our path is completely blocked," Captain Hewitt announced. "Then we have the rest of that ice field to get through. We have to move quickly. Henry," he shouted urgently, "check the engine."
"Aye, Captain," Henry replied.
He leaped down a hatch into the engine room and set about his diagnostic routine to figure out how to bring the engines back online. Fortunately, the flow of electricity from the batteries had been restored, just as mysteriously as it had cut out.
"Brian and John," the captain called, "prepare the deck for cruising."
Brian and John looked around and then at each other. There was almost no equipment left to prepare. The storm had ripped away almost everything and washed it overboard. Captain Hewitt observed that silent exchange.
"Very well, then," he said. "We'll get out of here straight away, as soon as Henry has the engines running."
Ropes dangled and tattered nets trailed from broken cleats, so Brian and John hauled them aboard to reduce their drag. Henry failed to find anything wrong with the engines. While the crew worked, Captain Hewitt function-checked the equipment.
To his surprise, everything appeared to be working normally. He checked his GPS and slapped it in disbelief.
"Great," he muttered. "We're in Baffin Bay. That shouldn't even be possible."
The storm had blown them into an eastern annex of the Arctic Ocean, a no-man's land of ice floes and fjords bordered by towering cliffs. The crew worked feverishly amid the thunderous reports of ice cracking and the thumps and splashes of the pieces hitting the ocean's surface. Their hearts thumped along, pumping adrenaline through their systems.
"The engines are online," Henry shouted from below deck.
"Clear," yelled the captain.
Henry backed away from the engines and climbed out of the cramped engine room. "The damaged equipment is clear," John announced a little prematurely.
"No, it's not,"
Brian corrected, hauling in a shredded length of net that clung to a mooring cleat.
"We caught something," he bellowed.
Captain Hewitt rushed over to the gunwale and stared in disbelief.
"Oh, my," he said. "Should we haul it in?" Brian asked.
Captain Hewitt took a quick look at the contents of the net.
"That's no marlin you have there, or sea bass, or anything else we can sell, and we need to get moving. Throw it back."
Caught inside the tattered fragment of net was a creature frozen in a block of ice about 10 feet long and 5 feet on each side. Through the translucent ice, they could see that the creature, which was stretched lengthwise, was larger than an average person. Before cutting the net loose, Brian took a last look.
"Wait a second. Check that out, fellas. It looks like that thing's wearing clothes. Jesus, I think that's a person in there."
All four men gathered at the gunwale.
"You're right," Henry shouted, "but those don't look like regular clothes. I can't see through all that ice, but it looks like he's wearing something like old, worn leather all over his body. I thought people stopped dressing like that 1,000 or so years ago. I wonder if he's as old as that."
"Maybe even older," said John, remembering his geology coursework about the Arctic ice. "This ice loses large chunks every year, but it gets replenished as well at the edges. The core hasn't been affected for tens of thousands of years. Over the last few centuries, global warming has gradually reduced the margins of the Arctic ice so that the ancient core is coming to the surface. If that guy was frozen in the core, who knows how old he could be?"
"So what about it, Captain?" Brian asked, remembering his orders. "Do I haul him in or throw him back?"
"We can't throw him back, Captain," John interjected. "He has to be important anthropologically. My school would probably love to study him." The captain turned his head sideways in thought. That appeared to be a dead man, and he believed in burials at sea and letting the dead rest in peace. But that was no ordinary dead man, and he couldn't ignore the difference. The last storm clouds parted, letting the sun shine warm and golden on the boat. The water glistened like a blanket. Captain Hewitt looked overboard again at the floating iceman tucked into the tattered remains of his net and was overcome with a paternal feeling. That man, he thought, was someone's son, someone's friend, someone's brother. He has, or had, a family, and I ought to take him somewhere.
"All right," he said with a dawning smile. "Bring him aboard."
"Wait until the school gets a hold of this," John exclaimed, already dreaming of the accolades he would receive for bringing in such a find. Brian and John hauled the Iceman aboard and shoved him into the freezer hole to keep him from thawing. They secured him against a wall with stacks of empty fish tubs. Beaten and exhausted, they finished preparing the boat to escape from the ice that could crush them to death if they tarried. The boat moved slowly as Captain Hewitt maneuvered around blocks of floating ice. The crew manned the forecastle with aluminum poles, calling out the position of low-lying icebergs and fending off the smaller chunks that bobbed in their way. It took them hours to navigate through and away from the ice field and out of the path of the major ice blocks. Finally, seeing a clear path ahead, Captain Hewitt shouted,
"Okay for full engine power."
"She's ready,"
said Henry, who'd found no problems during his further inspection of the boat. Captain Hewitt gave the engines full throttle, and the small boat took off like a racehorse, unbalancing the crew with its powerful acceleration. It quickly reached maximum speed. The Arctic wind whipped their faces painfully, but they drank in the smell of the ocean air. The days in the hull had taken a toll on their spirits, but the ocean wind and the smell of the salt water made them feel like they were home again. As he piloted the boat, Captain Hewitt made some rough calculations, figuring their location and remaining fuel. He realized there was no way they could make it back to New York directly, but at least they were away from the immediate danger. He radioed a general distress call, hoping the Canadian Coast Guard would hear it and offer assistance, while his crew returned below deck to warm themselves.
"Pon-pon, pon-pon, pon-pon,"
he called, using the code for a vessel in distress, but not imminently doomed.
This is Fishing Vessel Mozart. Repeat, Fishing Vessel Mozart. We are 75 degrees 9 minutes west, 62 degrees 5 minutes north. In need of fuel. Please send assistance.
He paused, waiting for a response, then repeated the call. Paused, and repeated it again. After a few minutes, a weak reply came back.
Roger, monsieur, the caller replied in a French-Canadian accent, making the words rhyme.
He arranged for his ship to meet them with fuel.
Captain Hewitt called the good news down to the crew, who were ecstatic that help was on the way. The adrenaline that had surged through them to keep their bodies moving and minds racing subsided, and they settled in to do their jobs. They were beyond the point of collapse, and looked forward to some true rest.